The sealing of the 144,000 tribe by tribe. We recall from our opening meditation of Revelation chapter 7 verse 14 that the 144,000 were a people who needed to be purified. That's Revelation 7 verse 14, where one of the elders had asked John, "Who are these?" And I said unto him, "Sir, thou knowest." And he said to me, "These are they which came out of great tribulation and have washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb." This scripture, if you read between the lines, tells you what? Doesn't it point out that these people were once not white? Doesn't it show there that it is a purification experience that they go through, which is much tribulation? So, when they go through this much tribulation that purifies them, what is written in the spirit of prophecy that Satan comes and points out in their past history? What does he point out to them in this time of tribulation? Here in Testimony Volume 5, page 473, we read in reference to these people. "The people of God have been in many respects very faulty. Satan has an accurate knowledge of the sins which he has tempted them to commit. And he presents these in the most exaggerated light." I was just reading from page 474, paragraph 1, but I'll come up to 473 first of all, where it says that Satan urges before God his accusations against them. That was paragraph 2. And in paragraph 1 it says that they are fully conscious of the sinfulness of their lives. They see their weakness and unworthiness. And as they look upon themselves, they are ready to despair. The tempter stands by to accuse them, as he stood by to resist Joshua. This is the vision of Joshua and in his filthy garments. He points to their filthy garments, their defective characters. He presents their weakness and folly, their sins of ingratitude, their unlikeness to Christ, which has dishonored their Redeemer. He endeavors to affright the soul with the thought that their case is hopeless, that the stain of their defilement will never be washed away. He hopes to so destroy their faith that they will yield to his temptations and turn from their allegiance to God and receive the mark of the beast. Oh, for us to be able to comprehend what inspiration is here trying to get across to us. How many people in the time since the sealing commenced have been overwhelmed with their unchristlikeness and have turned the doctrines of Jesus and the doctrines of the pioneers that have picked up these doctrines of Jesus, have turned them into error to say we're never going to be perfect. We are never going to make it. And so today, Seventh-day Adventism is saying perfection is an impossibility. Satan has succeeded to discourage people, to turn the doctrines into something that suits the awareness of one's sinfulness and still wants to have hope outside of God's truth. Here it tells us that Satan is there to turn them away from the truth. It says Satan urges before God his accusations against them, declaring that they have, by their sins, forfeited the divine protection and claiming the right to destroy them as transgressors. And then, as we read there on page 474, we then read on paragraph 2, while the followers of Christ have sinned, they have not given themselves to the control of evil. They have put away their sins and have sought the Lord in humility and contrition, and the divine advocate pleads in their behalf. He who has been most abused by their ingratitude, who knows their sins and also their repentance, declares, "The Lord rebuked thee, O Satan. I gave my life for these souls. They are graven upon the palms of my hands." So Satan is there. While Jesus is purging these people, he is permitting Satan to take them through great tribulation. The tribulation here described is a tribulation of an overwhelming sense of one's own unworthiness. And so, in these series of our camp here, we are examining just the sins of the 12 tribes as they came into existence through the forefathers' experience. We've studied Judah already. Now we are going into the study of Reuben. Because out of the tribe of Reuben, according to Revelation 7 verse 5, it says, of the tribe of Reuben were sealed 12,000. The tribe of Reuben. So let us go to the experience of Reuben, through which we will see how a life stained can be sealed. In Genesis 29, verses 31 and 32, we read when he was born and to whom he was born and what the agony of distress that was upon his mother, how that distress would have had a very powerful impact upon his development in the womb, his genetic blueprint of personality. That's Genesis chapter 29. We read it there in verse 31 and 32. Here it is. And when the Lord saw that Leah was hated, he opened her womb, but Rachel was barren, and Leah conceived and bare a son, and she called his name Reuben. For she said, surely the Lord hath looked upon my affliction. Now therefore, my husband will love me. That was the firstborn, Reuben, to Leah. And there was parental stress of the envy that was between Leah and Rachel. Parental stress that this little baby was born to. And so, here he was born to Jacob and Leah. And as he developed, as he grew and became a man, how did Jacob feel about Reuben? What was Jacob's observation about his son? Let's read it there in Genesis 49, verse 3. Genesis 49, reading verse 3. Reuben, thou art my firstborn, my might, and the beginning of my strength, the excellence of dignity, the excellency of power. So he was very proud of his son. The beginning of my strength. The excellency of dignity, the excellency of power. That's how he revered him. And as we look at Reuben, although he had this conflicting influence of that was put passed on to him through the mother's agony, like Judah, when the envy was against Joseph, as Joseph came to meet them there looking after the sheep, Reuben was repulsed by the murderous hatred of the brothers of Joseph. Let's see how Reuben reacts to this envious behavior of the brothers of Joseph. Let's come to Genesis again, chapter 37. So we are looking at Reuben here, the firstborn who was affected by the parental feud. And looking here at verses 20 to 21, there was something very precious inside of him as well. Genesis 37, verse 20. And he says to the brethren who were going to slay Joseph, "Come now, therefore, and let us slay him," say they, "and cast him into some pit, and we will say, some evil beast hath devoured him. And we shall see what will become of his dreams." And Reuben heard it, and he delivered him out of their hands and said, "Let us not kill him." And Reuben said unto them, "Shed no blood, but cast him into this pit that is in the wilderness, and lay no hand upon him, that he might rid him out of their hands, to deliver him to his father again." So here was this oldest brother who, although he was affected by Joseph's, by the brothers in envy over him, yet he did not want them to kill him. He wanted to save him. That was a very beautiful trait of character. And in verse 29, it goes on to describe the picture. They threw him into the pit, and then when the Ishmaelites came, they sold him. And Reuben returned unto the pit, and behold, Joseph was not in the pit. And he rent his clothes, and he returned unto his brethren and said, "The child is not, and I, whither shall I go?" So he was really distressed because he came there to try and save Joseph out of the pit. They were going to leave him there to die. But then when, as we read about Judah, Judah said, well, let's not let him die, let's sell him so that at least he wouldn't die. But Reuben had also plans of a different nature to save their little brother. And so as we continue to ponder upon this, let's just read there in Genesis 42, verse 22. At an occasion when they were now in the presence of Joseph, not realizing that he was Joseph in the land of Egypt. And here you can hear Reuben answering. And Reuben answered them, saying, spake I not unto you, saying, do not sin against the child? And you would not hear. Therefore, behold, also his blood is required. For they knew not that Joseph understood them. And he spake unto them by an interpreter. So here was Reuben still smarting under their activity and saying, you know, I told you so. Look what's happening to us now. His blood is upon us. And so we read this beautiful account of the in the spirit of prophecy, in which the character of Judah, although of Reuben rather, is played out in an honorable state, just like Jacob had expressed, yet there were certain influences in his life that caused him to become sullied as we continue to study. But here we come to Patriarchs and Prophets, page 211, where we read, they would have executed their purpose but for Reuben. They would have killed him but for Reuben. He shrank from participating in the murder of his brother, and proposed that Joseph be cast alive into a pit and left there to perish, secretly intending, however, to rescue him and return him to his father. Having persuaded all to consent to this plan, Reuben left the company, fearing that he might fail to control his feelings and that his real intentions would be discovered. So now you see something here. What's this character? He wasn't going to stand up to them and let them know what he was going to do. So, although he had such a good attitude about saving his brother, but he was a shifty person. He was unstable. He wasn't prepared to stand up and be counted. Can you see this kind of character manifestation here? And so they threw him into the pit, and Reuben wasn't there. And then we come to page 212. Reuben returned to the pit, but Joseph was not there. In alarm and self-reproach, he rent his garments and sought his brothers, exclaiming, the child is not, and I, whither shall I go? Upon learning the fate of Joseph, and that it would now be impossible to recover him, Reuben was induced to unite with the rest in the attempt to conceal their guilt. Having killed a kid, they dipped Joseph's coat in its blood and took it to their father, telling him that they had found it in the fields and that they feared it was their brother's. So, what kind of a character was Reuben? Can you see here when in the story? This is for us to explore. What sort of a character was he? He had good traits of character, but the other traits of character were a shifty, pliable sort of person who, although he wanted to do good, when he was put in a corner, he went along with his brothers. He wasn't even honest with his brothers in the first place. If he would have been the good older brother with a strong personality, he could have said, no, we will not do this, we will save him. He could have saved Joseph. But no, his character gave in, and he was outwitted by the events. And then he was actually going along with them to do what? To be a false witness as to what actually happened. This is the character of Reuben. And in the midst of all this, look at something very beautiful here about Reuben. Genesis 30, verse 14. And remember why we are studying this. To also discover where we may fit in to this, whichever tribe that we are studying in. Do we have similar traits of character? In Genesis chapter 30, verse 14, we have an interesting picture of another aspect of his character here. Genesis 30, verse 14. And Reuben went in the days of the wheat harvest and found mandrakes in the field and brought them unto his mother Leah. Now, what's mandrakes? If you read in the margin, it says love apples. Love apples. So obviously this was a gift that he gathered to give to his mother. He was a loving person. He loved to make his mother happy. Was that a good trait of character? That's beautiful, isn't it? He was a beautiful young man. And so we see here a mottled personality. Beautiful traits of character, strong traits of character for good, but also character deficiencies, very severe. And the reason why he did not, because he was the oldest son, he should have received the birthright. Why did he not receive the birthright? What was there in his behavior that was a grievous sin? We go to Genesis 35 there, verse 21 and 22. Genesis 35, verse 21 and 22. And Israel, that's Jacob, journeyed and spread his tent beyond the Tower of Edar. And it came to pass when Israel dwelt in that land that Reuben went and lay with Bilhah, his father's concubine. And Israel, Jacob, heard it. Wow. Let's come to Genesis 49. And read there verse 4. Here's the reason why he did not receive the birthright. Genesis 49 verse 4. We read verse 3 and 4. We have read verse 3 already, how that Jacob admired him for his dignity, excellence of power. But then, unstable as water, thou shalt not excel, because thou wentest up to thy father's bed, then defiledst thou it. He went up to my couch. He laid with Jacob's concubine. And therefore, although he was the firstborn, he would not receive the birthright. He was unstable. And that's what we saw, didn't we? Unstable. He wanted to stand up to protect his brother, but he was unstable. He didn't make it very clear. And then his instability, the marks of parental dysfunction, When you look at it very closely, not only did Jacob have Leah and Rachel, he had another two concubines as well. Can you imagine the family dysfunction of this and the effect upon the children? Here we have an attitude that Reuben had taken hold of and violated his character. Let's come to 1 Chronicles chapter 5, verses 1 and 2, where an explanation is made in reference to his birthright failure. 1 Chronicles chapter 5, reading there verses 1 and 2. Now the sons of Reuben, the firstborn of Israel, for he was the firstborn, but for as much as he defiled his father's bed, his birthright was given unto the sons of Joseph, the son of Israel. And the genealogy is not to be reckoned after the birthright. Interesting. The genealogy is not to be reckoned after the birthright. And that's how we started last night. Although Reuben was the firstborn, who was placed as the firstborn? We studied Judah. He was regarded as the firstborn to some degree, as we keep on reading. For Judah prevailed above his brethren, and of him came the chief ruler, but the birthright was Joseph's. So Judah was placed in first place, the birthright was placed to Joseph. And so there was a splitting of benefits, but not to Reuben. Reuben lost it because of his grievous sin. How seriously does God regard this sin of what Reuben did? Fornication. Testimony, volume 2. Let's read it there. Testimony, volume 2, reading from page 450, where it says, not all who profess to keep the commandments of God possess their bodies in sanctification and honor. The most solemn message ever committed to mortals has been entrusted to this people, and they can have a powerful influence if they will be sanctified by it. Couldn't Reuben have been a powerful influence? They profess to be standing upon the elevated platform of eternal truth, keeping all of God's commandments. Therefore, if they indulge in sin, if they commit fornication and adultery, their crime is of tenfold greater magnitude than is that of the classes I have named, who do not acknowledge the law of God as binding upon them. In a peculiar sense, do those who profess to keep God's law dishonor him and reproach the truth by transgressing its precepts. Serious. Adultery, fornication. Very serious. It was the prevalence of this very sin, fornication, among ancient Israel, which brought upon them the signal manifestation of God's displeasure. His judgments then followed close upon their heinous sin. Thousands fell, and their polluted bodies were left in the wilderness. But with many of them, God was not well pleased, and he quotes the scripture. So, a very, very serious sin in the tribes of Israel. This serious sin, together with his shifty character, unstable as water. Let's explore a little the effect of sin on Reuben and those affected by it, and also his progeny. What does this sinful character, what sort of an impact does it have on people around and on his own children? Let's come over here, an interesting statement that comes forth. The attitude that affected Reuben with regards to this situation of Joseph, and as they now had to go back to Egypt with Benjamin in the story that we have already looked at briefly, Jacob was not going to let Benjamin go. And now notice in Genesis chapter 42, what a kind of an attitude Reuben has. The effect of sin upon him is described here in Genesis 42, verse 37, where Judah had said, well, I'll stay here and become your servant, when he said that to Joseph there. This man speaks this way to the father. Genesis 42, verse 37 and 38, it says, and Reuben spake unto his father, saying, slay my two sons, if I bring him not to thee. Deliver him into my hand, and I will bring him to thee again. This is Reuben speaking to his father, because now they had to take Benjamin. And verse 38, he said, my son shall not go down with you, for his brother is dead, and he is left alone. If mischief befall him by the way in which you go, then shall you bring down my gray hairs with sorrow to the grave. Jacob didn't trust him, did he? Reuben was prepared that the father should slay his two sons. What sort of a father is that? Can you see the mentality of sin affecting people so that they draw judgments of this nature? This is the character Reuben displays, a character of carelessness with regards to life. Because he was so careless in so many other things. Let's come over to Exodus 20 and read there the last part of verse 5. Just as we continue to explore this personality trait, this character, and the way it affects people. That's Exodus chapter 20, reading there in verse 5. The last part of that, where it talks about this effect of sin upon the person himself and upon his children. Here it says, we know this scripture very well, where God is speaking and says, I, the Lord, am a jealous God, visiting the iniquity of the fathers upon the children unto the third and fourth generation of them that hate me. The effect of Reuben's sin affected his offspring and the nation or the tribe of Reuben thereafter. There was a tribal weakness that was affected by Reuben's example. Before we come to Numbers, let's just notice here what Sister White writes in Great Controversy in reference to this, so that we get this picture very clear, the condition of being, because sin has affected the character. It's Great Controversy, reading there from page 474. It says, every sinful gratification tends to benumb the faculties and deaden the mental and spiritual perceptions. And the word of the Spirit of God can make but a feeble impression upon the heart. That's what we saw, because of the sinful gratification of Reuben, it benumbed and deadened the mental and spiritual perception so that he could say to his father, you slay my sons if we don't bring Benjamin back. That's the mental benumbing, you see. So that the Spirit of God can make but a feeble impression upon the heart. So a person with the characteristics of Reuben has a very feeble response to the impressions of the Spirit of God. Notwithstanding these inspired declarations, how many professed Christians are enfeebling their powers in the pursuit of gain or the worship of fashion? How many are debasing their godlike manhood by gluttony, by wine drinking, by forbidden pleasure? And the church, instead of rebuking, too often encourages the evil by appealing to appetite, to desire for the gain or love of pleasure, and so on. She describes how even in the church, people are affected. And so we're talking about the tribe of Reuben, the people who have been affected by sinful circumstances around them and by their own indulgence of sin. And here in describing this a little further, let's go to Numbers chapter 32. Mark again what we are studying here, and look at your own experience as Satan comes along and points out your hopeless state. Isn't this a hopeless description here? That even your response to God is benumbed because of your past sins? It's frightening. Here it is, Numbers 32, verse 1. Now the children of Reuben and the children of Gad had a very great multitude of cattle. And when they saw the land of Jazer and the land of Gilead, that, behold, the place was a place for cattle, the children of Gad and the children of Reuben came and spake unto Moses and Eleazar the priest and unto the princes of the congregation, saying, what are they saying in verse 5? We just miss out a few extra wordings there. Wherefore said they, if we have found grace in thy sight, let this land be given unto thy servants for a possession, and bring us not over Jordan. And Moses said unto the children of Gad and to the children of Reuben, shall your brethren go to war, and shall you sit here? And wherefore discourage you the hearts of the children of Israel from going over into the land which the Lord hath given them? What were the Reubenites doing? They were the shifty same personality that has been passed on to them from their forefather. Let's just stay here. We don't want to go any further. This is good and comfortable here. And how discouraging were they upon the others? You see how sin, in its benumbing effect, comes through. And as I examine my life, as I examine and see the activities of humanity around me, you can see this happening. Look back at your past life, how it affects you now. Look back at your parents, how they have affected you. This is the picture that's described here. And so, if we come to one more, the consequence of this kind of sinfulness is wrought out in 1 Chronicles chapter 5. 1 Chronicles chapter 5. And we read there verse 26. Because of the Reubenites' weaknesses, it says here, and the God of Israel stirred up the spirit of Pul, king of Assyria, and the spirit of Tilgath-Pilneser, king of Assyria. He carried them away, even the Reubenites and the Gadites and the half-tribe of Manasseh, and brought them unto Halah. So here is the consequence. A people who are faulty, when the enemy comes in, they become overwhelmed. Because the enemy uses the weaknesses that have been passed on. That's what Satan does, doesn't he? So here we've described a picture that looks pretty hopeless, doesn't it? What hope has Reuben got? What hope have the people with Reuben's personality and sin's background, what hope have they got to be among the 144,000? When you read about the 144,000, we touched on that last night, they are without fault before the throne of God. And you think, what hope have I got? What hope have people got that have got Reuben's background? Satan points them out to you, as I read out in Testimony Volume 5 at the beginning. He knows all about the past. And he says, these people have no right to be among the 144,000. In spite of these unstable tendencies of the tribe of Reuben, does that disqualify these personalities from gaining a place among the 144,000? Well, we already read in Revelation 7:5, of the tribe of Reuben, 12,000 were sealed. Well then, let's go to Deuteronomy 33, verses 1 to 6. Deuteronomy 33. Verses 1 to 6. Now, you know, we have seen a terrible picture of sinfulness and all the effect of sin upon the progeny, upon, when I see my parents, when I see my father, and I said, I never want to be like that, and I end up being exactly like that because it's passed on. Here in Deuteronomy 33, when we see ourselves as we really are, is there hope to be among the 144,000? Deuteronomy 33, verses 1 to 6. And this is the blessing wherewith Moses, the man of God, blessed the children of Israel before his death. He said, the Lord came from Sinai and rose up from Seir unto them. He shined forth from Mount Paran. He came with 10,000s of saints from his right hand when a fiery law went from his right hand went a fiery law for them. Yea, he loved the people. All his saints are in thy hand, and they sat down at thy feet. Every one shall receive of thy words. Moses commanded us a law, even the inheritance of the congregation of Jacob. And he was king in Jeshurun when the heads of the people and the tribes of Israel were gathered together. Now notice verse 6. Let Reuben live and not die, and let not his men be few. What a statement to make of such a corrupt background. Let Reuben, God blessed Israel, but then says, made a special blessing point about Reuben. Let Reuben live and not die, and let not his men be few. So Reuben was to be blessed, and the Reubenites could be sealed, no matter what their background was. Notice here what Sister White, under inspiration, expresses to the people who have been so sinful. It's Testimony Volume 5, page 513. It says, she's writing to this young man, you are a young man of intelligence. You desire to make your life such as is will fit you for heaven at last. So this is a person who wants to be among the 144,000. You are often discouraged at finding yourself weak in moral power, in slavery to doubt, and controlled by the habits and customs of your old life in sin. Here is the description. We, like Reuben himself and the Reubenites, accustomed controlled by the habits of and customs of your old life and sin? Can you rid yourself of your old life? Have you tried? How difficult that is? Customs and habits. Remember, habits for our components of character. You find your emotional nature untrue to yourself, to your best resolutions, and to your most solemn pledges. Resolutions, pledges. How many times we falter in our resolutions? How many times, because of our customs and habits of the past, we just don't seem to make it? Here is the problem. Nothing seems real. Your own instability, wasn't that the character of Reuben? Unstable as water. Your own instability leads you to doubt the sincerity of those who would do you good. The more you struggle in doubt, the more unreal everything looks to you, until it seems that there is no solid ground for you anywhere. I can never be among the 144,000. But the Reubenites could, some of them. It says, the more you struggle in doubt, the more unreal everything is. Your promises are like ropes of sand, and you regard in the same unreal light the words and works of those in whom you should trust. What a hopeless state. But notice what Sister White says. You will be in constant peril until you understand the true force of the will. You may believe and promise all things, but your promises or your faith are of no value unto you until you put your will on the side of faith and action. If you fight the fight of faith with all your willpower, you will what? Conquer. Your feelings, your impressions, your emotions are not to be trusted, for they are not reliable, especially with your perverted ideas and the knowledge of your broken promises and your forfeited pledges weakens your confidence in yourself and the faith of others in you. But you need not despair. You must be determined to believe, although nothing seems true and real to you. Oh, can you identify with these words in hope for our situations? You are not to despair, although nothing seems true and real to you. This is our experience as we go forward further, right into the time of Jacob's trouble. Nothing seems real to us anymore. I know this experience so well. I need not tell you it is you yourself that has brought you into this unenviable position. You must win back your confidence in God and in your brethren. It is for you to yield up your will to the will of Jesus Christ. And as you do this, God will immediately take possession and work in you to will and to do of his good pleasure. Your whole nature will then be brought under the control of the Spirit of Christ, and even your thoughts will be subject to him. Can a person like Reuben be among the 144,000? And the answer is in what? The action of the will. I want to read from Ministry of Healing as well. Ministry of Healing 497, where it says, some, this is paragraph, it's actually 498, paragraph 1. Some have no firmness of character. Their plans and purposes have no definite form and consistency. They are of but little practical use in the world. Their weakness, indecision, and inefficiency should be overcome. And how was it? By the will. So we've got this unstable condition as Reubenites, those who have that unstable condition, who will not stand there and say, no, I'm not going to go with you in killing our brother. I'm going to take him back. Yeah? That kind of indecision, this unstable as water condition, this weakness, indecision, inefficiency should be overcome. There is in true Christian character an indomitableness that cannot be molded or subdued by adverse circumstances. We must have moral backbone and integrity that cannot be flattered, bribed, or terrified. It can be overcome. This is possible. And so indeed, why were 12,000 of the tribe of Reuben able to be among the 144,000? Because they learned that lesson. They understood this and realized no matter how weak and pliable and unstable as my character is, I am using the power of God's word and applying myself, my will, so that God can do the work within me because I'm placing my will there. And so we come to Judges 5 as we come to the conclusion with these next few scriptures. Judges 5, verse 16. Judges 5, verse 16. And the Lord said unto him, surely I will be with thee, and thou shalt smite. Sorry, that was 6. That was 6. Judges 5, verse 16. Why abodest thou among the sheepfolds to hear the bleatings of the flocks? For the divisions of Reuben, there were great searchings of heart. Why was Reuben able to be among the 144,000 as a representative? Not that he himself will be, but the people of Reuben's character. The divisions of Reuben, in the divisions of Reuben, there were great searchings of heart. This is the important exercise. We must put our effort into being part of the 144,000. If we discover that our sins and our weaknesses are so heavy upon us, like they were upon Reuben, as we search our hearts, as we apply ourselves to be among the 144,000, we can conquer, we can overcome. Let's read it there in Lamentations 3. And we've just gained the wonderful answer. It's where we place our will. Lamentations chapter 3, verse 40. You know, what I'm sharing here is not just a story. This is the answer to our individual personal battles. How important the subject is at this conference. Lamentations 3, verse 40. Let us search and try our ways and turn again to the Lord. Deep heart searching, Reubenites. Whatever your past has been that you can equate with Reuben. Although he was such a devout person for standing faithful to the true, to caring for his brother, although he was a loving and lovable person, yet these other sins had affected him even from the background of his parents, so that he didn't look upon polygamy and adultery as such a serious thing. All this could have prevented his tribe from being among the 144,000. But those who will search their hearts, do diligent searching, can, by personal examination of their soul with God's word, they can overcome. Is not that what is written for the people of Laodicea? Revelation 3, verse 21. What was that that we read also last night? He that overcometh will sit with me in my throne, even as I overcame and sit with my Father in his throne. Jesus became one with us, as we heard again this morning. He himself had to struggle through those terrible sins that he didn't practice, but that were laid upon him. And he conquered, and he shows us that by exercising our will, we, even though we have been Reubenites, can overcome as he overcame. And therein, Selected Messages, Volume 2, page 318. 2SM 318. In paragraph 2, oh, that you would search the Scriptures with prayerful hearts and the spirit of surrender to God. What are we to be doing? If we realize how sinful we are, if we realize that we may be of the Reubenite mentality and of the Reubenite disposition, and it looks pretty hopeless as we were reading, what are we to do? Do what Reubenites did. Do some deep heart searching and search the Scriptures. Now, did you notice here, it's not just study the Scriptures to get the doctrines right. It's searching the Scriptures with prayerful hearts and a spirit of surrender to God. Oh, that you would search your hearts as with a lighted candle and discover and break the finest threads that binds you to worldly habits which divert the mind from God. Plead with God to show you every practice that draws your thoughts and affections from him. God has given his holy law to man as his measure of character. By this law you may see and overcome every defect in your character. You may sever yourself from every idol and link yourself to the throne of God by the golden chain of grace and truth. And so the people who can identify with Reuben's character and Reuben's searching of heart, they can see, we are living in the sealing time, and no matter what my background is, I can search the Scriptures in such a way that I will conquer my sinful background. May we take courage from this study. And if you can identify with Reuben, don't despair. Amen.